started getting questions for the session. I've got a question where this person said pain and mental health are inseparable. Keeping that in mind, how would you define pain? I'm assuming pain and loss is what they're talking about.
Absolutely, you're completely right. And in fact, this is one of the major reasons why we're seeing a rise in substance use as well. And by substance use, I'm particularly talking about opioid and alcohol. These are substances, particularly opioids, that are used to actually dull pain, but not just physical pain, but also psychological pain. And these two kinds of pain experiences are deeply interconnected. This is why after the 2008 financial crisis in the US, there was a dramatic increase in opioid abuse and life expectancy of working age Americans. Well, this is the work that led to the Nobel Prize in Economics to Angus Deaton. They've written a terrific book called The Depths of Despair. So to answer your question, the word despair captures psychological pain, but the deaths were occurring due to opioid use that was being prescribed for what was seen as physical pain. These are inseparable qualities in our human experience.
So are you expecting to see a rise after 2020? I mean, like it happened after...
Luckily, in India, we still control the use of opioids. And so thankfully, I don't think we're going to see kind of a picture that we saw in the US. But in the US, there is an uptick of opioid overdoses already in the last 6 months. I think we're going to have to be extra careful in this country to make sure that those kinds of narcotic analgesics do not become widely used on the street, of course. We have to be very careful because there is a real risk of people being directed in that direction. Instead, what we need, Sanjita, is better mental health care and relief from the stressful economic implications of the pandemic. I want to repeat what we talked about earlier. We have the solutions. We know that cash transfers, either conditional or unconditional, and access to low-intensity mental health care can help break this vicious cycle between poverty and poor mental health. Let us implement this at scale.
Right. I have another question from Raghav, who wants to know, how does pressure and stress affect mental health?
Well, you know, stress is part of everyday life and it affects our mental health. And most times it's good. Okay, because if we didn't feel stress, for example, when there's an imminent exam or you have to prepare for an interview, well, then you won't actually have that extra level of arousal that you need in order to perform at your best. So let's not think stress is bad. What is really bad is when that stress becomes toxic. And by toxic, we mean when it is pervasive, when it goes on for an extended period of time, and when there is no escape or relief from that stress. That is when your mental health starts suffering adversely and you develop a mental illness.
But that's what's happening now. So what would your tips to people be? How do you deal with
that? All right. Okay. Well, my tips to you are a few things. First of all, acknowledge your mental health in the same way that you acknowledge your physical health. Imagine if you had a sudden acute pain in your chest, you wouldn't just sit around saying, oh, well, that's all right. No, you would immediately acknowledge it. And the next thing you do is do something about it. So for mental health, when you sense that there's something unusual happening that you don't recognize as part of your good mental health, talk to someone about it, because that alone can be a very, very powerful therapeutic procedure. It can help you feel a lot better immediately. Many people find benefit from distraction, particularly by getting engaged with activities, physical or otherwise, that you find enjoyable, listening to music, going for a walk. Meditation helps a lot of people, and there's a good physiological reason for this. There's no particular school of meditation, but any kind of meditation, from prayer to mindfulness to yoga, all of these are very helpful. And finally, I don't think you should ever feel embarrassed to seek help. There has never been an easier time than now to seek help from counselors and professionals, thanks to telemedicine. You know, you can sit in your home without any fear, without any stigma attached to going to a mental health clinic and access mental health professionals directly through the large number of opportunities for telemedicine that are currently available.